So as threatened in the October livestream, I wanted to give you my take on some of the reviews of the new Blade Runner film. And calling them reviews is probably too generous. The ones I look at here are more like hysterical rants. So this is not going to be a review of the film as such, but it will contain many spoilers. So don't say you weren't warned. So Blade Runner 2049 appears to have been received quite well. It got a fresh rating of 88% on Rotten Tomatoes, and the audience scored at 81%. It got an 8.4 from over 140,000 users on IMDb, and it got an 81 on Metacritic from 51 reviews. But of course, it's a movie. People have different tastes, and some people didn't like it. The National Review described it as hack. The Spectator thought it was a dull, mainstream blockbuster, although the author of that piece, Deborah Ross, admits that she found the plot confusing. Perhaps that had something to do with the negative review. But there is a particular type of reviewer that is only capable of seeing what they want to see through the narrow prism of their own ideology, in this case, being female victimhood. Just like the ideological infinite polygon that I reported on a couple of days ago, that could only see female characters as victims of violence against women in the most recent Last of Us Part 2 trailer, despite the fact that women in that trailer were also portrayed as strong, brave, and capable. So let's have a look at the New York Post. "You'll love the new Blade Runner, unless you're a woman," says Sarah Problem Glasses Stewart. "Female characters get the short end of the stick in this long-awaited dystopian sequel. They are drowned, knifed in the stomach, shot point-blank in the head, and in one instance, simply winked out of existence with the stomp of a boot. All, it must be said, with artful cinematic relish." Oh, so you mean they were killed in the same way as men have been routinely killed in movies for decades? I'm sure you said that about the horrific murder of men in Bone Tomahawk, didn't you? Anyway, Robin Wright's character, Joshi, is a hard-ass lieutenant. You know, someone engaged in that line of work that involves physical danger.
Joshi is Kay's boss. She has a very commanding presence.
What you saw didn't happen.
And brought a real sense of authority and dignity and compassion to their relationship.
This breaks the world, Kay. Do you know what that means?
You want it gone?
Erase everything.
And spoiler alert, she's the one that gets stabbed by the even bigger badass female replicant, Love. Love is played by Sylvia Hoeks, and this is what she had to say about that character.
What I like about this character is that she doesn't have to be sexy. She doesn't have to be the girlfriend. She doesn't have to be the mother.
Where is he?
And as you may have gleaned from that little clip, she kicks a lot of ass. But in the end, she gets taken out as well. But again, not surprising given the line of work that she's in. And she forgot to mention possibly one of the most important characters in the film, Dr. Anna Staline, a leading designer of replicant memories for the Wallace Corporation. Now, I won't give away why she's so important. She doesn't have a big role in the film, but she is central to the plot. And she doesn't get killed, nor is she a badass, a prostitute, or a stripper. Director Denis Villeneuve is entirely faithful to the original, in which one of the most gorgeous and terrible scenes is of a stripper replicant cut down in a hail of bullets as she crashes dramatically through multiple plate glass windows. The shrieking, stomach-shredding death of Daryl Hannah's standard pleasure model bot, Pris, runs a close second. Now, I agree that Zora crashing through the plate glass windows is a memorable scene, but there are plenty of things that are faithful to the original. So why does she choose these two in particular? Well, because she can allude to the female victimhood narrative, the murder of a stripper and prostitute, or pleasure model, as Pris is referred to. But she leaves out that in the original, Zora was only stripping as a cover. And so in the new film, Mariette, a prostitute who does resemble Pris, is also working undercover to get closer to Kay, Ryan Gosling's character. I'd like to think this follow-up to Ridley Scott's 1982 Blade Runner, whose rainy noir aesthetic informed just about every sci-fi flick that came afterward, is a cautionary tale about a society that views women as disposable and/or as outright slaves. But seeing as it's mostly about Ryan Gosling's officer Kay, a Blade Runner tasked with executing older model replicants pondering his own existence, I think I'd be wrong. Of course, why wouldn't female victimhood be the central theme? The film is about what it means to be human, and that struggle is played out through the replicants and the Blade Runners, Deckard in the first and Kay in the second. And it's kind of in the name, isn't it? I mean, it's not called Disposable Slave Girls, is it? Although, I might watch that. And just because we see a stripper and a pleasure model, that means the original film was a society in which women were disposable or slaves. Well, what was the purpose of the other male replicants in the original? Well, they were designed specifically for working on off-world colonies with limited lifespans, just like the other replicants. Or in other words, disposable slaves. There are no female characters that aren't replicants in the first film, but you just go ahead and assume the human population of women are disposable slaves too. The level of projection is stunning. But this review is nothing compared to the bile-laden crap on Vice. Why Blade Runner 2049 is a misogynistic mess. Women in the sci-fi sequel are either prostitutes, holographic housewives, or they die brutal deaths that we are forced to watch in horrifying detail. Hey girl, Ryan Gosling may have taught us about some of the greatest feminist thinkers of all time, but he now stars in Blade Runner 1949. Oh, sorry, 2049. That's supposed to be feminist humor, and that's why I didn't laugh. A misogynistic mess, and the most overrated movie of the year. The fact that it has drawn near universal glowing reviews tells you more about the paucity of women film critics than it does about the successes of the film, which I will list for you now. It looks fucking cool because the cinematography is amazing, and Ryan Gosling's character Kay has a nice coat. No, all that tells you is that you're in the minority. The original Blade Runner is not without issue in the misogyny stakes. Even in 1982, they should have steered clear of including a rape scene. Yeah, I don't think you can say the sex scene between Deckard and Rachel was rape. But given the ever-expanding definition of rape these days, the fact that he looked at her probably qualifies. But in 2017, we should expect more of our directors than Denis Villeneuve offers here. Armed with a colossal budget and an experienced cast, Villeneuve has proceeded to make a completely flat, emotionless, nonsensical, and eye-gougingly sexist film. I think she's actually describing her own review. Women are either literally prostitutes, holographic housewives like Joy, a product that is marketed with the lines experience joy, everything you want to hear, everything you want to see, or some slightly meaner, more violent boss women. Robin Wright as Lieutenant Joshi and Sylvia Hoax as Love, also a companion, but one who can kick ass, who nevertheless meet gruesome deaths that we watch in horrifying detail. Men also get killed, of course, but we don't watch their eyes bulge for tens of gratuitous seconds. They are blunt, noble deaths, not desperate, fetishistic ones. Again, how much victimhood and projection can you pack into one paragraph? You're treating the movie as your own personal Rorschach test. What'd you expect? Did you think the big final showdown between Kay and Love was just going to end with a shot to the head? Of course it was drawn out. It was meant to be dramatic. And again, so what if women get killed in a gruesome way? If you're not equally appalled when men are killed in movies in the same way, then your sexism is showing. Or perhaps you could just lighten up and realize people get killed in movies and their gender has nothing to do with it. At the risk of a spoiler alert, there is one woman, Dr. Anna Staline, who is held to be more precious than the others, but she's holed up in a literal glass cage and infantilized to fuck, living in fantasy worlds of her own making. Not to mention that the ultimate dividing line between human women and the hyperhuman replicant women is that real women can give birth. Did you get that? If you don't give birth, then sorry, you're not a real woman. It's hard to believe she actually watched the movie. The doctor is holed up in a glass cage because she has a genetic disorder. Think Bubble Boy from Seinfeld. And yeah, just calling yourself a woman doesn't make you one. The ability to give birth is actually a prerequisite. Or in the event that you can't give birth for some reason, at least having been born with the appropriate plumbing. It is arguable that in Ridley Scott's original, the misogyny was part of the dystopia, and this sequel is just following on from that. But if 2049 is making a point about how adaptable patriarchy is to technological advance, then the problem is that it just doesn't make it. Instead of implying in any way the problematic nature of Kay having a holographic fantasy girlfriend housewife, for example, the film instead humanizes her role to the extent that we're supposed to believe this is a legitimate, loving relationship rather than titillation and affection slavery. Yeah, I'm sure that's what the creators intended to do, to make a point about the adaptability of the patriarchy to technological advance. Here's a tip for you. No one cares about the patriarchy except for hysterical feminists. And now we get to what I suspect is the most triggering aspect of this movie for femtards, the fantasy girl Joy. Joy is a software-generated hologram, a fantasy girl that can take on multiple personalities, the quintessential 50s-style housewife, a sex kitten, but most of all, she is a companion. And this is precisely the point missed by the rabid feminist author. Kay is a replicant and is reviled by his human colleagues, with the possible exception of his boss. He lives an isolated existence, and so the holographic girl he comes home to is a companion. Who knows what is possible with AI in the future, but I think it shows a lack of imagination that an advanced AI capable of learning and that resembles a human couldn't become a companion for a loner like Kay.
Joy's a sort of ideal woman. They have a very complicated relationship because Kay is so isolated and alone.
I love you.
You don't have to say that.
I know. Joy is warm and sensitive, funny, sexy, someone easy to talk to. She really shows love.
So Joy represents everything that men like, or in other words, everything that feminists are not. The movie Her was devoted entirely to this concept, and like Her, there is a sex scene where Joy enlists the help of the replicant prostitute Mariette to substitute an actual physical body. I mean, you can say Kay is engaged in self-deception about the nature of his relationship, but it is more about companionship than sex, given his circumstances. Contrast that with the fact that for decades women have used electronic devices as sex aids, not for companionship. But a holographic girl with an advanced AI system that perfectly replicates human behavior is affection slavery, but a dildo that reduces a male to a single sex organ is absolutely fine. The hypocrisy is breathtaking. And for conclusion jumpers out there, no, I have absolutely no problem with dildos and vibrators, but I do have a problem with double standards. It is the only relationship in the entire film, not exactly true, and implies that through her sensitive subserviency and domesticated care, she is actually more human than the human women who have become hardened, man-like warriors or cynical, bedraggled whores. Man-like, but I thought men and women were the same. And again, nothing of the kind is being implied. Given that Joy is essentially perfect, depending on your tastes, I'd say that makes her distinctly less like human women. The massive and completely inexplicable stone statues of slim but busty naked women left strewn around a desert scene are really the perfect metaphor for this film. Undoubtedly huge, but truly a dusty relic long out of time. Yeah, because a naked statue equals misogyny, and because it'd be too much to expect a feminist to understand the concept of beauty and appreciation of the human form through art. But we all know the real problem. You can never please a feminist, and you shouldn't even try. They will never be happy, and they will go out of their way to try and ruin your enjoyment of something as simple as a movie. But the good news is Blade Runner 2049 is a thoroughly enjoyable sci-fi flick. The cinematography is amazing, the soundtrack is fantastic, and successfully recreates the feel of the original movie. My only complaint was that at 2 hours 45 minutes, it was about half an hour too long. I felt the cinematic release could have been the extended director's cut. But don't let that stop you. Just remember to take a piss before you sit down, and you'll be fine. So, were you horrified by the violent and sexist portrayals of women in Blade Runner 2049? Let me know your thoughts in the comments below. I'll see you next time.